cannot tremble with indignation at the idea that the man that blew the whistle on the war crimes is in Belmarsh and the war criminals are on the BBC and ITV and raking in millions and millions and millions and millions of pounds?
Okay, that was the great George Galloway, former MP and host of Mowat's Mother of All talk shows, which you can see at a million different platforms. He actually has 2 million viewers, and that's from St. Pancras Church in London back when I was there in February of 2020. During the Belmarsh first phase of the extradition trial hearing for Julian Assange. By the way, I'm Randy Credico. This is Randy Credico live on the fly here on the Progressive Radio Network. His colleague, his former colleague, they were both at RT for many years together, Afshin Ratanzi. That's George Galloway's colleague, at RT, Afshin Ratanzi, who is an award-winning investigative journalist. He's an author and one of the smartest guys around, seriously. And but George is no longer on RT, and I believe that Afshin is, but on many other platforms as well. And I visited him when I went to Russia and then to Donetsk, part of the Donbass. On my way there, I spent a couple days with him. On my way back, I spent a day and a half with him. And he's really a wonderful person to hang out with. The conversation's great. And we basically carried on a conversation the other day. I pre-taped this on Thursday with Afshin because he's very busy and it's a 9-hour difference in time that much later over there. So I taped him, and here he is coming up for the full of, I played segment of it the other day on another network, but I'm playing the full 50-minute interview with him right now. So Going Underground, you got to watch it. Look it up, Going Underground. Afshin Ratanzi really is, he could be on any, he could anchor any network program. If he were to sell out, but he's never sold out. And that's the reason why we love him so much and why I find him such an interesting guy. Integrity galore, great stories, very knowledgeable. I will, and by the way, I saw him when I was at the Belmarsh Tribunal way back, or the trial, not the tribunal, but the trial back in February 2020. And we hung out. I met him for the first time, and he's interviewed Julian Assange more than anybody that I know. And you can catch some of those interviews with Assange. They're really quite deep and very entertaining. I hate to say entertaining, but they are. They have a great rapport. Look up Afshin Ratanzi's interviews with Julian Assange and just about anybody else. He gets guests that you cannot believe. And I don't believe some of these people actually go on the show, and that would be people that are not on the same page with him politically, but he's able to like bring them in and then cut them to shreds in a very unique manner. So what we're going to do here is go to some music, which is banned now and at Lincoln Center. Lincoln Center banned the production of Shostakovich's Seventh Symphony, the Leningrad Symphony. Can you believe it? They banned it. So the mass hysteria now, they did it to Carl Milk in 1917. The Boston Symphony banned him from playing. because of the anti-German fever. So now they're banning anything that's Russian, and it's all part of an attempt to cancel their culture, okay, which is like musically and literature-wise the most profound culture on the planet. But we're going to continue to play Shostakovich. In fact, we're going to play him right now. Then we're going to go to the and then go right into the interview with Avshin. And I won't be speaking to you again. After that, we'll have some closing music, and we'll see you next week. I'm Randy Credico here on the Progressive Radio Network. Okay, that was a suite for Variety by Dmitri Shostakovich, banned in almost every place in the West, but not here at Progressive Radio Network. I'm Randy Credico. We are back, as I promised. We have with us, I think, the foremost news show host and news show co-producer, the award-winning great author, journalist, investigative journalist, my good friend who I just saw on the way to Russia. Funny thing happened. I stopped in Dubai to hang out with Avshin Ratanzi, host of Going Underground, and the executive editor and co-producer, Colette. Welcome back. It's been a long time, Avshin.
Way too long. You got to come back and visit us in the Middle East at the place for refugees from Europe, in terms of media anyway.
Right. I'm certainly not going to go through the UK because, I was watching, your show last week. You had a journalist from Saudi Arabia. I don't know his name, but he was saying that he felt better in Riyadh than he would if he were in London doing what he's doing. Did you find that to be interesting or what? Or do you
it's quite,
find it to
quite
be
something? Quite something. I mean, you know, let's face it. A year or so ago, the idea of the editor of Arab News, that was Faisal Abbas, on the editorial board of Al Arabiya, one of the biggest news networks throughout the Middle East and the Arab world, telling me, "Look, I'm British educated, and I feel safer in Saudi Arabia as a journalist." But of course, I think you're already intimating. It was on the tip of your tongue. That this week's news of the wonderful, the great Kit Clarenberg for Grey Zone being stopped at Luton Airport. A bit like, I mean, it's happened before. I think Kit was interviewed somewhere saying, you know, on that particular terrorism legislation to attack journalists, it hasn't been done before. But wasn't it Glenn Greenwald's late husband who was also attacked in that way and brought eventually to the Guardian newspapers, where his laptop was destroyed in front of the former civil servant in Britain. But it's terrible. I mean, we always say, oh, it's getting scarier. You know, Julian Assange is being tortured in London, in a London prison. But every week, every month, every year, it just seems to be getting worse and worse.
And, you know, that's one of the reasons why I won't go to London or the UK anytime soon. I took those photos of Julian at Belmarsh, and I got a feeling if I were to go through, I would be sequestered and questioned and possibly charged for contempt of court. So, I mean, what has happened to the UK? How did they slip all the way down where they're, you know, it's like better in Singapore or anywhere else than it is in the UK? It seems like the worst place in the world to practice free journalism.
And yet the European Union Foreign Minister Josep Borrell talking about Europe being a garden and the rest of the world being a jungle. I think even American journalists like yourself, comedians. I mean, you're free to do what you're doing there. I know that sources are not protected over there. That's why Edward Snowden had to flee to Moscow with the help of Julian Assange. But journalists, the American military-industrial complex has different ways to deal with journalists, more sophisticated ways in a country with a titular First Amendment for press freedom than to do the kinds of things they're doing in London, in Britain, or in Europe. I'm not sure how many journalists could be stopped at JFK Airport in New York and be quizzed about their opinions of different things, as if indeed this was HUAC committee times and Joe McCarthy.
Well, talk a little bit about that journalist from Gray Zone. Just a little bit, what they were so upset about and what happened at the airport, because a lot of these listeners don't know.
Yeah, so I mean, I don't want to say I know him that well. I think I've come across him, but you can't remember. I mean, because he writes spectacular pieces that investigate and illuminate the secret state all around the world. And rather than being quizzed about his patriotism, arguably, any normal society, I suppose this is what those defending themselves to the McCarthy Committee used to say. They're defending the American way of life. I think he would say he's defending a notion of British freedom whilst being detained by police when he arrived. I'm not quite sure whether on the plane arriving from Serbia, he arrives in Luton. I think he was just there to see his parents, and the police, I'm not sure if they boarded the plane, but they took his phone, they took his tablet. I've just seen an interview with him where he talks about how they were returned with the little cameras on the mobile phone and on the tablet covered with a piece of sticky tape. I was thinking, is that because the British intelligence services would have been thinking, we may have confiscated his equipment, but he's probably spying on us now. And whatever state actors, you know, Beijing, Moscow, we better cover it up with a piece of sticky tape. Otherwise, the MI5 headquarters or Scotland Yard headquarters will be bugged. I mean, this is Keystone Cops territory. I have to say one other thing, the fact that your listeners don't know about it, and the fact that more people in Britain, I haven't noticed any coverage of this on the major networks in Britain, that a journalist has stopped and being quizzed on his political allegiances and what he thinks of Russia, what he thinks of the British Prime Minister Sunak. Can you imagine an American journalist arriving at JFK being quizzed by the FBI and who knows whom, the CIA.
I was expecting that.
Joe Biden is? Well, but they're going to go, yeah, what do you think of Joe Biden?
I was expecting that on April 18th when I flew from Dubai to JFK, on my way back from Donetsk, Mariupol, and Moscow, and having a couple of days vacation in Dubai. But I thought when I got back that was going to happen to me, to be honest with you. But it hasn't so far. But I'm always looking over my shoulder.
So there were no questions to you, even though you had the visa stamps as a journalist and so on. That would be the equivalent of you returning from a journalistic assignment, basically, to the United States and being told, look, what's your opinion of Joe Biden? Because you've just been to outside of the country. And actually, that's the thing. Kit didn't even go to a war zone like you. He didn't go to Ukraine where your government is pouring in billions of dollars of weapons. He just lives in Serbia and he was visiting his parents. So, I mean, the mind boggles.
He's a British citizen, isn't he? He's a British citizen.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. Yeah, I mean, I think actually what they did ask him was what he thought of Max Blumenthal, the editor.
Yes.
Editor of the Gray Zone.
Yes. I mean, I've almost have interviewed him. I haven't yet, but the occasion just didn't arise. But we were both trying to hook up at one point or another. But I certainly would like him now. But I'm sure he's very hot and people want to talk to him. I mean, what is happening there? Is this the result of the reason why you left the UK? Is this, tell us about the amendment to the Official Secrecy Act or the...
The way he was stopped was under Schedule 3. I don't know which piece of anti-terror legislation. I mean, since the loss of habeas corpus, I've lost track of the amount of legislation that they resurrected from the civil strife in Ireland, of course, because under when the Troubles were going on, so-called, clearly they could just stop anyone in the north of Ireland, and they didn't need reasonable suspicion, and they could just lock them up forever. And of course, there were miscarriages of justice. And then it's been morphing, this kind of legislation, obviously after 9/11. I notice over here, at least, you can carry a bottle of mineral water with you without having to throw it away before you go on to security before flying. Someone suddenly realized, have we actually stopped Al-Qaeda bombs with this new technique and lip salve? Who knows what? The types of legislation have been one on top of another, which have given rise to a situation that we know, which is basically, isn't it? They can, under terrorism legislation, lock you up forever, as far as we can tell. And in the United States, it's clear that Guantanamo Bay torture prison is still there in occupied Cuba. And theoretically, that deterrent remains to anyone, I would think, anywhere in the world. There's so many multinationals, prisoners still in there. So I mean, I don't know what the law is that does it. The law why I'm have to be here is that I make television programs that go to countries across the world, and in Britain you cannot sell programs or get programs distributed on channels that are headquartered in countries that are enemies of the state. And of course, I mean, I have to say, it's not only RT that's banned in Britain, it's Fox News, the Murdoch channel, as well as CGTN and Al Arabiya, actually, from broadcast in Britain. So these are just draconian, you know, freedom.
Are they in a state of emergency? I mean, is the UK in the state of emergency at this point? I mean, I don't think it was this bad during World War One.
I mean, there were radio broadcasts by Nazi sympathizers, famously, coming through during World War II. And in World War One, yeah, dissent, as far as I knew, was being allowed. Were done the Daily Worker, communist papers in the First World War. There were very rich elites allowed to pontificate in the British press about how they sneakingly liked Hitler in World War II. And here we are in a situation that I think is completely unlike World War II. There's no way that Britain is fighting the Nazis here. Britain is pouring weapons to fuel a conflict to avert any type of peace talks that could be arranged through China.
I just read that that the U.S. and the rest of the world now is getting together, wanting peace talks, and the two countries blocking such talks are the U.S. and the U.K. Why are they so hell-bent and stopping negotiations? Is this about money for their military industries that pour money into their campaigns? Or is this about both countries being fading empires and acts of desperation?
Yeah, I think historians would probably say it must be the latter. This is desperation's the last gasps of a dying empire. But given that we're living in this, we ourselves find it difficult to admit that that could possibly be this be so. I mean, they can't really be that self-destructive. I mean, Joe Biden, Anthony Blinken, Victoria Nuland, Jake Sullivan, Rishi Sunak, who's been in Washington, he's talking to Biden this week. They have children. I mean, they don't want to destroy the earth, do they? But everything they seem to do, I know Biden has been doing some pretty weird climate destroying antics this week. Clearly, they don't really have a long-term vision of anything. And so far, the European Union has gone along with it, it has to be said. But now things seem to be speeding up, don't they? I mean, the BRICS summit, the BRICS foreign office, the foreign ministers summit, ahead of the BRICS leaders summit in South Africa, with Lavrov there talking about the fact that Zelensky is a neo-Nazi puppet. This is common currency in most of the world that the United States and Britain are supporting reactionary far-right neo-Nazism. And yet the media, there's a blackout in Britain and the European Union, where there is restrictions on all press freedom, and in the United States, they don't really need to do restrictions, do they? They don't need to make restrictions on your corporate media, because so disciplined are your personnel in network news at ABC, CNN, ABC, NBC, and
all of them.
CBS, that they don't even need to be told anything, as Chomsky warned us about.
Right. You know, I have friends who are contacting me all the time. They knew I was there. They're in the mainstream media, one from the Wall Street Journal, the other one from Yahoo News. I won't mention their names, saying, why aren't you driving around with a truck with the Wall Street Journal reporter that was out there and arrested? And I said, well, why aren't you out there for Julian Assange yourselves? These two reporters, like everybody else I know, have not been out there calling for the release of Julian Assange, questioning his credentials as a journalist. So there's
in fairness to one of them, I think I know who it is. In fairness to one of them, I think he did expose the assassination attempt.
How did you guess?
I guess it was him. But as for that Wall Street Journal, the Rupert Murdoch Wall Street Journal journalist who's been convicted of spying, what was he doing in thousands of miles from the epicenter of where the war is occurring? Shouldn't he be on the battle lines telling us the truth? Because we know that in the fog of war, truth is the first casualty. Tell us. Tell us bad things about Russia. Tell us bad things about Ukraine. Tell us bad things about the whole of NATO countries that are arming Ukraine up to the teeth, to the last Ukrainian. Could do so. But I certainly thought it was weird when Gonzalo Lira, the American journalist, has gone missing, disappeared in Ukraine, and is asked at a State Department press conference by a journalist, I think it's from the Epoch Times, I don't know, it's not a mainstream publication, but he got in there to be able to ask the question. And the State Department spokesperson just shrugged the shoulders and went, no, I don't have anything on that. Suddenly, you know, if it's that Wall Street Journal guy being convicted of spying in Russia, it is...
Has he been convicted?
Appalling. If it's a U.S. citizen who is being detained in Ukraine, we presume, let's all hope he comes home safe, the State Department say nothing.
Yeah.
Well, what would they have said if you'd gone missing in Donetsk?
Well, they would have said nothing. None of these people, and we'll get to the kill list in a minute, but I want to get back to this Wall Street Journal reporter. What's his name? Gronovich? What's his name? Is it Gronovich? You know, he did. I was there simultaneously.
Are Wall Street Journal journalists really journalists? That's a question.
No,
we have to be fair to all journalists, but... You know, I think it's now established, given the Julian Assange litmus test of who supports him and who doesn't. If you don't support Julian Assange, are you really a journalist?
Right.
I mean, can you be?
He's got more awards than everyone that I know that's in mainstream media combined, major awards, with the exception of John Pilger. And of course, he's
not that awards are always a good way to go, of course, because as we know, wasn't there awards for exposing Russian interference of elections that were after the latest Durham report we know were complete fakery? When is that Pulitzer Prize going to be handed back?
Well, I want to get, let me get back to this Wall Street Journal journalist. I don't know what he is, but, you know, I was
he
there.
He works for Rupert Murdoch.
I was there simultaneously.
You know
okay?
what I mean? He works for Rupert Murdoch. We know right. what Rupert Murdoch has done to suppress labor movements all around the world, whether in Australia, in Britain during the miners' strike, who knows what against the trade union movement in the United States. We know what Rupert Murdoch does. He mystifies populations with tabloid hackery to stop them thinking about the real causes of their pain and misery. We know who Rupert Murdoch
right,
is, don't
right, we? Right. But I was there simultaneously as this Rupert Murdoch journalist, you know, so-called journalist. I don't know if he is or not. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. But I went west when I got there. And if he's a seasoned journalist, he went east. He went to the industrial area where the military, you know, construction buildings are. And but I went to an area. Why didn't he go there instead of me? Seriously,
why? I mean, what would happen to a Russian journalist in the United States if they were hunting around the Raytheon factory or the Northrop Grumman factory or the what are these other big arms companies?
Boeing
in Seattle. What would happen to them? I think even if they looked around a civilian airliner, I think I did a tour. I had one of those day tour things when I was about 10 around the Boeing factory in Seattle, Washington State. I mean, we had to get security passes. I was in the 70s.
If they were looking around, you know, looking at the design of a Lionel train set, they'd probably get arrested. So you don't remember those Lionel train sets, but
Britain had Hornby. Actually.
Okay. All right, so I just can't figure out why
made
was
in China?
What?
Those train sets made in China?
Yes, yes. We're going to go to war with China just so we can, you know, confiscate those train sets.
I don't know what's happened to the toy industry in your country. Anyway.
All right, we're talking with Afshin Ratanzi of Going Underground, which you can watch anywhere now, right? I mean, you broadcast around the world, various vehicles.
All across Latin America. It is on some cable, apparently, in the United States, but all across Africa, all across Southeast Asia, most of the world can see it, but it's completely blocked out in Britain, where I was born, and in the European Union, it's banned.
In other words, there's no way I could get access to it if I were to go to UK and go to...
can. I mean, this is the absurdity. You can
there, if I were in London. Rumble.
You can watch it on Rumble online in Europe and in Britain, except France, because France, home to the Delacroix, Liberty Leading the People picture, has banned Rumble, which is just an alternative video platform, sharing platform to Google, the Pentagon contractors one called YouTube.
Right. Going Underground, it's such a well-produced show, and the producer and editor is Colette, who I got to spend some time with. You guys do a marvelous job. How many hours do you have to put in a week? First of all, getting the guests that you have, doing all of the research before you go in, and then doing the editing, because it's like seamless, you know.
As your producer Kelly knows, it's a nightmare. But we have an amazing team. I mean, the kind of guests we got in the past few weeks. I mean, on Saturday's show, we have the former president of the UN General Assembly, the former foreign minister of Serbia, about NATO's second front through Kosovo to attack Serbia and any country in Europe that is not abiding by Antony Blinken's plans for the world. And we've also got actually coming up classical civilization. What's it? Michael Hudson, the economist, who's written a amazing book about the origins of the collapse of antiquity and why that relates to your debt ceiling negotiations today and how we were lied to about Rome and Greece. But most recently, we had the Mozart Group mercenary boss in Ukraine, an English soldier. Within hours of it being broadcast, the mercenary group from Britain dissolved. So that's the power of journalism when you can do it. You don't even have to fight.
How do you get those guests? How do you get those guests?
We just have amazing producers. I mean, they are amazing, committed producers who have to monitor everything. And as you said, the time it takes is literally 24/7. I'm sure you've noticed that. I mean, I don't know what political comics are doing. I don't know the state of political comedy in the United States, but things are moving so fast and at such a speed. If it was only the other day, Biden said he was only going to give helmets to Zelensky's so-called neo-Nazis. Now he's about to give F-16 jets, warplanes, ammunition. The British are going, hey, we don't even mind if you attack Russia with the equipment we send. Everything is moving so quickly. And de-dollarization amongst the global south. The other day, the UAE is stuck coordinating some sort of marine patrol in the Persian Gulf, where I am. Saudi Arabia making peace with Iran. The Syrian leader arriving in Saudi Arabia for the Arab summit. Lula talking about how terrible the things are in the United States. He's out of jail, and Brazil is trying to negotiate the new way. But, of course, Maduro is over there. The world is changing. You get such a pace, and all of these events are interconnected that it's difficult but fascinating. I just wish so many people weren't being killed in Europe, because Islamist violence seems to have suddenly disappeared the moment the United States started focusing on this war.
Well, everyone in South America, with the exception, the one disappointment is the president of Chile. We'll see if he gets back on board with this new cooperation that Lula's talking about. What about this meeting that's taking place in St. Petersburg coming up, the summit there?
Yeah, there was actually a story about that, wasn't there, that secretly the European Broadcast Union, these one of these quangos of to unite all different journalists, people and broadcasting organizations under one umbrella. The BBC is in there, a whole bunch of ARD from Germany and all the rest of it, had secretly, they did Eurovision coverage, which was this British, European song contest, which should have happened in Ukraine, which Britain hosted because Britain is in love with Zelensky. Anyway, they secretly made an application to have a big interview with Lavrov without telling all the other broadcasters, because, of course, all the other broadcasters are thinking to themselves, wait a minute, we can't even cover anything Russian. We can't actually say anything nice has ever happened in Russia. You started with Shostakovich and so on. But somehow St. Petersburg is making some of even them think, hang on, all these important people are going to St. Petersburg to talk about a new world order that is going to ditch the Federal Reserve's dollar plans for the world, let alone the Western European catastrophic economic situation. Germany went into recession. This powerhouse of Europe is in recession, which means everything is going to be disastrous for Europe. Some broadcasters thought, hey, we've got to look at St. Petersburg. So St. Petersburg is where it's all going to be happening. But then this year has the BRICS summit. It has another Shanghai Cooperation Organization meetings. These big U.S. networks are going to have to realize that covering Blinken and Biden nodding along wherever he goes, I'm not sure he has any trips planned, it's kind of pointless. You've got to see where the world is moving.
Now, will it be safe in St. Petersburg, or do you think the British-backed batteries that are coming out of the U.K., Ukraine, that flew into Moscow, drones, will they actually possibly do something with those, with the UK's okay hitting St. Petersburg during that?
Well, the UK is, the Foreign Minister James Cleverly has been clear that he completely understands attacks within Russia, knowing full well the British weapons are going to them. So until Russia does, Russia keeps threatening things, doesn't it? It's a bit like China. Keeps saying, oh, look, you know, we'll do something. Russia doesn't do anything. And I think that only encourages the British to think they can keep doing it. But St. Petersburg, of course, was the site of an appalling assassination against a journalist, a bomb hidden in some sort of statue award that was being given to the journalist. People can read up about it. I don't know whether British or American special services, secret services were involved in it. In a sense, they are de facto involved in it, because weaponry is being supplied to the Ukrainians, and this was clearly an assassination in St. Petersburg that benefited Ukraine, because if you kill journalists who are telling the truth, if you kill comedians that are telling
the truth,
it benefits the narrative.
I was there when that happened, when that journalist was killed with that statue. And it happened a day before I went to Donetsk, and I said, wait a second, am I safe going there? And when I got there, I did a lot of interviews, DPR-affiliated news media, and I said, do me a favor, don't put this out until I've left town, okay? Seriously. And they didn't until I came back to the U.S., and suddenly I end up on this kill list. What is the West?
It's a serious kill list. You know, people are trying to minimize this kill list somehow. Oh, what kill list? I mean, this is an important kill list, because people who've been on the list then get killed.
Right. This guy Dugin's daughter was killed, right? Alexander Dugin's daughter was killed, yeah. And the journalists in St. Petersburg. It is a serious kill list. And you don't, what does Zelensky say about that? What does the UK say about it? Is it with their imprimatur? Is it okay?
Well, I mean, I wonder how the Americans are protecting you, given that they're supplying the weapons you'd presumably be killed with for being on the list. Are the Americans, did they immediately spring into action, come into your home and say, we'll protect you, you're an American citizen. We have the biggest defense budget on earth. No harm will be done to Rodney Credico. I don't think they did do that, did they?
Right, no. There's so much that has happened since I was there. By the way, I really enjoyed hanging out with you and Colette, except for, being on the patio on the 34th floor. And you know, I'm like Jimmy Stewart.
I just didn't know. You're scared of heights.
I'm really, if I get on a step ladder, I panic.
Yeah, but I didn't understand. The first thing Colette, the editor of Going Underground, said to me was, so he's going to a war zone, clearly where there's violence, where according to U.S. media, hundreds of thousands of people have been killed, and you're going there. And what if there's shelling by the United States armed troops, and you're told, well, the only safe place is this place on a balcony in a building? What are you going to do? Just die.
I was on the third floor in that hotel room when I was in Donetsk, and I was more nervous about that than I was about a Heimer. No, I'm just kidding. The same journalist I told you about before, who seemed to have no concern about Julian Assange, seemed to have no concern about me being on that kill list, and they refused to write stories about it. And it's not just me, it's other people that we know. It's also Roger Waters that's on this kill list. This is an odious, reprehensible, scary development, and yet you can't find anybody to write about it. So how do we protect ourselves if the media is not going to expose it, or at least, be sympathetic to it? Why are they not sympathetic to me, but they are to this guy who, as far as I know and what I've heard, was a spy?
What's disturbing about that, of course, is it's now been exposed that the internet servers on which is hosted the list that has your name and your picture on it for assassination, along with Roger Waters, the Pink Floyd genius, and so many others, journalists from all around the world. What's disturbing is the servers are set up by NATO, is it? Or is it U.S. intelligence agencies? So that's another spin on this as to why journalists may not feel comfortable trying to defend those who are clearly targeted for assassination using that list. So that's another more sinister element of this.
We're talking here on WBAI and also Progressive Radio Network. I don't know how much longer. I think we may be a target of government censorship. It seems like I just got banned.
You have a First Amendment. It's impossible.
Right. You think that there are publications that were stopped from, if you read American Midnight, which I know you did, 1917 to 1921, there were tons of publications that were repressed because the Postmaster General, just most of them were through subscriptions, like the masses. They were totally suppressed and not allowed to use the U.S. mail system to, mail out their newspapers. So I don't know. I mean, should I be in fear? Not me in particular, but this station here, that by talking to you, talking to, let's say, the deputy ambassador from the UN, from Russia, who I've had on four times, do you think that we are on somebody's radar looking for ways to eliminate us on the airwaves?
I mean, by the viewing figure numbers for your show, for my show, for other shows, and the declining viewing numbers for so-called mainstream media, clearly we will be worrying elites. But on the other hand, what's perhaps the most worrying element of all of this is, in fact, I mentioned it actually to a guest we're having on Going Underground soon, is that we're coming up to the anniversary of the Amazon factory strike in Staten Island, where they won a victory. And people thought that there were going to be victories for trade unions across the United States. That didn't happen, which means that workers are just too tired to bother with understanding the American government's clamping down on freedom of speech, on freedom to gather, maybe, and the freedom to understand why their tax dollars are being wasted thousands of miles away, tens of thousands of miles away, trying to catalyze what can most, you know, at one point even that serial killer Henry Kissinger was even saying is going to catalyze the World War III and Armageddon. So yeah, that's really disturbing that, you know.
Do you think that's possible? I mean, I do think it's more possible. Now, I know we all thought about it in the past, the specter of a nuclear war. Do you think is it more realistic to you, more tangible in your brain that this possibly could transpire, which would be the end of the world?
I'm a bit alarmed that Jeffrey Sachs, the Columbia University professor who was advising the IMF and World Bank, a senior establishment figure, said, we are. Noam Chomsky's always been saying it for a while. I think, you saw the destruction and the appalling way that US and British and EU weapons are being used on civilians in Europe. And everyone says Putin plays the long game. He's not going to react in the kind of madman way that the U.S. and the NATO nation media describe it. That itself doesn't make sense, because if NATO nation media thinks Putin's mad, then he will use the nuclear weapon. But on the other hand, as these attacks increase within Russia, there must be a huge constituency in Russia that will vote the other way at next year's Russian elections, won't they? They'll say Putin is not protecting our citizens if Putin does not act in some bigger way against NATO nations. But then, of course, the people advising Putin are presumably saying this is the trap they're trying to lay for us. It's noticeable that China, too, are making statements that we couldn't have envisaged a decade ago that are clearly designed to make the United States think again as it sends its billions of dollars of weapons through the South China Sea. Who will fire first? Well, I mean, what if Britain is already sending depleted uranium, so there's arguably enough of a radiation in the breadbasket of Europe, Ukraine, to poison generations. That's what some people are speculating about. As to the use of a tactical, as they call, nuclear weapon for the battlefield as opposed to the destruction of entire nations, I mean, this is what Blinken, Biden, Nuland, Sullivan are risking, and all their vassal state servants, Sunak and Macron and the like.
Right. What about other states like Poland and Hungary? There's a difference between the two. And now Turkey, with Erdogan being reelected, can you just kind of lay out those three?
I mean, it goes back to what I was saying about Amazon. If you have a situation of mass poverty, malnutrition in Britain, one out of five, or is it one out of three now, children growing up in poverty? If you've got this kind of neoliberal chaos as they blew up the Nord Stream and destroyed their energy reserves in Europe, exacerbating poverty, where even the Economist magazine said way more people died of cold this winter than would have normally done, and it was worse than COVID. If you're getting this kind of situation, it allows elite power in Hungary, in Poland, in Western European capitals to be able to do what they like, because democratically people are just too tired to be able to bother about thinking about some other country's foreign policy, something out there. They're just too busy feeding their families. And it's this class dimension to the analysis that is required here, because clearly the elites in Davos, in Bilderberg, in the European Union meetings believe they can do what they like. They have a compliant journalistic class. They imprison and detain any journalist that doesn't toe the line, who might want to educate the population. They've got, they've rewritten the history. They can censor the music. They've got everything. It's full spectrum, cultural, social, historical control. The elites can do what they like and it doesn't matter.
we are that beaten down. You know, I the inertia in this country.
Points of light, though, like this program, and there are other programs. I'd say it's more vibrant in the United States than it is certainly in my home country of Britain. You know, there are points of light.
Do you miss living in Britain?
Well, of course, there's always a sentimental attachment to your home country, isn't there? So, of course, I do. But then as someone who was visiting me here said the other day, if it's problematic meeting neoliberal elites in new countries you may visit, think about Britain at the moment, where you have a totally propagandized multi-class experience, where there is no sympathy with Russia. There is no sympathy with the woman you interviewed in Donbass, making your pizza, whose friends were all killed with American and British and EU weapons. There just isn't. They only see it in one way, and they've got it completely upside down. So how would you interact, and how safe would it be? It was already not that safe, so my editor said, to walk on the streets for fear of people saying, you sympathize with Nazis, when I wanted to say, no, you sympathize with Nazis.
They sympathize with Nazis. And that's what I saw when I was, and I don't think I mentioned this to you before, in Donetsk, when I had a meeting, this building, I was in an administrative building, and there was a big meeting there, and they talked about that and about the Nazi propaganda. Not only they talked about it, I saw tables full of Nazi not just propaganda, but all sorts of evidence.
You imagined it.
No, I've got it. I've got pictures of it, stuff that was recovered.
There's so much video of it. The BBC were covering it. CNN was covering it only 5 years ago. So how can it have disappeared? I mean, I had people on my own team, I have to say, before moving, who would say, Afshin, call it allegedly Nazi, call it neo-Nazi. And then I'm thinking, but wait, some of the insignia here is so exactly the same as the SS headquarters.
Yeah, and Hitler. And then the statues of Stepan Bandera and all these other members of the Galician or the Nightingale Battalion.
To which they make excuses and say, oh, but Bandera was imprisoned by the Nazis at one point. And they managed history, and the rewriting of history has been very successful by elite classes.
Yeah, well, Ciano was in Italy, was imprisoned by the Nazis, and didn't make him not a fascist for the previous 20 years, right? So give us, this is, we're coming to the end here. I just want to ask you, give us like some kind of positive overview or negative overview, but going forward, just kind of wrap it up in, Andy Rooney style, where it's all going. It's in your hands. You got the concluding words, and you can bring Colette in if you want to join.
It's about Assange. You know, it's about Assange. And it's amazing how he is being forgotten in Britain and across Western Europe and the world. I try to use, as a journalist, and I hope every journalist listening to this realizes, you cannot do stories on international affairs without accessing the WikiLeaks database with U.S. State Department cables, which show you what was really going on with U.S. foreign policy, whether it be in the United States, even though it's foreign policy, Latin America or Africa, Southeast Asia or East Asia. I can't seem to get access. Obviously, WikiLeaks is no money, apparently. And the lawyers and legal teams that have been fighting Assange's case, I just don't know what is, and there's not, you know, you do the most that anyone can do. You've got that banner and you do everything you can to help him. I just don't see that happening with all the people I went to Julian's 40th birthday with the largesse of his benefactor, Vaughan Smith in Norfolk, when he was electronically tagged there. I do notice the great Stefania Maurizi. In fact, that's what I should end with.
Right.
An amazing Italian journalist has managed to get a court to investigate what was going on at the so-called British Crown Prosecution Service, which is the prosecutor's office in England, which was then run by the British, now British Labour leader, Keir Starmer, and we already have Sir Keir Starmer, and we already have a few leaks from that where his office was deliberately telling the Swedish government that they must not drop these fake sex charges against Julian. And so how is Starmer, who is associated with the assets of the intelligence class in Britain, he went to MI5, signed the visitor's book, this British Labour leader writing high in the polls. Stefania Moretti has got a British court to say, why were some documents destroyed relating to this? So maybe we can get to some kind of clues so many years on as to why all that rubbish and slander against Julian Assange and sex allegations was ever in the news at all, because that was very cleverly used by the state intelligence apparatus to destroy his reputation and character.
You know, it baffles me somewhat, and I was going to let you in, but I got to bring this up, that this court actually did something that was favorable to anything directly.
I know what you mean when you say baffled. You mean nothing will come of it, and there's going to be another court person who's going to go, what, you did that? Forget it. We know how terrible the courts are. That's why, in a sense, we're fighting the extradition, because we know about your secret grand juries in Virginia. So, and we know, and has been so much being written about the court system in Britain, the magistrates with their alliances to the British intelligence services. What we've got in Britain is no free press, complete power over the judiciary, and what do all these things and poverty and malnutrition. Mass poverty. What does that all equal? No democracy. I think we've got to stop calling these places democracy.
Right. You know, if they were to remake Casablanca, I would say Rick would be getting letters of transit for Victor Laszlo and Ilza out of London. Okay. You know, they want to get out of London.
Getting so decrepit, it's nowhere near as romantic as Morocco. I tell you that.
All right. We've been talking to Afshin Ratanzi, the host, and I what is your title? Co-producer, producer, co-producer.
Nothing. I'm just the public. Saturday and Monday.
Saturdays and Monday. And once again, how can people watch it?
You can watch it on RT, and there are sister networks around the world, and you can watch it on rumble.com/goingundergroundTV, and Elon Musk's Twitter. It's unshadow banned so much. I know you got your Twitter account back. It's unshadow banned going underground for the first time for 15 years or 12 years since we started the show. So watch out for our Twitter account as well.
And what is the Twitter account now? Would you lay it out for people?
We did have to keep changing that, didn't we? I think it's Going Underground TV or Going Under Unscore TV. But if you look at my Twitter handle there, it's quoted there. But things are more platforms, new ways of getting to the people. Google cannot stop everything. And Amazon and all these PayPals of this world, they can't stop it. There will be ways to get this information out to people all around the world, and we're doing it.
Well, thank you for all the work that you've done and for your great team. It's at Afshin Ratanzi. You can follow him on Twitter, and please do. I'm going to call you the professor. I hope people brought out their pencils and paper and took notes, because you're not going to get this kind of analysis of what goes on, whether it be in Turkey, Russia, Sudan, South America, anywhere. You're not going to get that here, is what I'm saying. But consistently, you can watch it on Going Underground, and I really urge that you do.
Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls pick them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the young girls gone? long time passing. Where have all the young girls gone? Long time ago. Where have all the young girls gone? Gone to young men, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the young men gone? Long time passing. Where have all the young men gone? Long time ago. Where have all the young men gone? Gone to soldier everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the graveyards gone? Long time passing. Where have all the graveyards gone? Long time ago. Where have all the graveyards gone? Gone to flower everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever learn? Where have all the flowers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the flowers gone? Long time ago. Where have all the flowers gone? Young girls pick them, everyone. When will they ever learn? When will they ever?